concept of rock Middle East by recognizing Jerusalem as capital of Israel. Man charged in connection with suicide plot to kill British Prime Minister. And Time Magazine's Person of the Year is a lot more than just one person. Good evening and welcome. U.S. President Donald Trump will recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital later today and set in motion the relocation of the American embassy from Tel Aviv. The Talon Buchner reports the decision upends decades of U.S. policy and risks fueling violence in the Middle East.
U.S. officials say recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital will be an acknowledgement of historical and current reality rather than a political statement. But moving the embassy from Tel Aviv could take up to 3 or 4 years because of the numerous logistical and security details. The planned move is drawing intense Arab, Muslim, and European opposition and risks potential violent protests.
The American embassy is going to be moved to Jerusalem. This is against international law, and this would be unacceptable from our side. If this happened, it would complicate things. It would put an obstacle to the peace process. Maybe it will be the end of the peace process.
As a matter of principle, the Secretary General has said that he has consistently warned against any unilateral action that would have the potential to undermine the two-state solution. And we've always regarded Jerusalem as a final status issue that must be resolved through direct negotiations between the two parties based on relevant Security Council resolution.
The U.S. State Department is warning of unrest in the Middle East and told American citizens not to travel to Jerusalem's Old City or the West Bank.
I just want to be clear that we take the situation seriously and we're closely watching it, as we often and very frequently say to you, the safety and security, not only of U.S. personnel, but American citizens at home and abroad, is a top issue here.
In Gaza, the Hamas rulers called a meeting of Palestinian factions and militant groups, calling for a day of rage against the announcement. Alan Buchner, TVB News.
A 20-year-old man has been ordered held in custody after being accused in a plot to assassinate British Prime Minister Theresa May. Nam Zachariah Rahman, is shown on the left here, has been remanded in custody at Westminster's Magistrates Court. The plot allegedly involved planting a bomb near the entrance of Downing Street and then continuing the attack with a knife and suicide vest in a bid to kill May in the ensuing chaos. Has been charged with preparing acts of terrorism. Another man was accused of trying to join Islamic State but wasn't charged in connection with the assassination plot. The two men were arrested in London and Birmingham several days ago. We'll find out soon whether Britain can deliver on a Brexit divorce package to the European Union. A last-minute hitch is jeopardizing the country's chance of a smooth exit from the European Union and of a future free trade deal with its biggest market.
Britain and the EU came close on Monday to agreeing on key Brexit divorce terms, including how to maintain an open Irish border after the UK, including Northern Ireland, leaves the EU. But the deal was scuttled when Northern Ireland's Democratic Unionist Party, which keeps the government of British Prime Minister Theresa May in power, would not back it. DUP says it can't allow any divergence in regulation between Northern Ireland and other parts of the UK. In other words, Northern Ireland must quit the EU on the same terms as the rest of the UK.
We want to have good relations with our next door neighbours in the Republic of Ireland, but we are not going to cut ourselves off from the rest of the United Kingdom.
EU officials have said a deal on money is effectively done, and there are indications of agreement on citizens' rights. May, who met with Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy in London, wants the EU to open the second phase of Brexit negotiations concerning relations after Britain's withdrawal on March 30, 2019. But she's now under pressure to have a deal hammered out ahead of the mid-December EU summit It will decide whether Brexit talks can move on to future relations and trade.
Talks within the European Union have made a lot of progress. There are still a couple of issues we need to work on. The plan will be reconvening in Brussels later this week as we look ahead to the December European Council.
Some EU member states are concerned they will not have enough time to scrutinize draft guidelines for the trade negotiations if they do not receive them a week before the summit. If the trade offer cannot be made by then, a senior EU official has said the whole process might have to be put back until February.
Russian President Vladimir Putin has announced he will seek re-election in March next year. Putin made the announcement in front of an audience of workers at an automobile factory in a city in the Volga region of Russia. Putin said he couldn't find a better place and a better moment to announce his candidacy. At another event earlier in the day, he was asked about running but stopped short of declaring his candidacy. The move sets the stage for Putin to extend his dominance of Russia's political landscape into a third decade. With his approval ratings topping 80%, Putin is certain to win a quick victory in the March 18th vote. Putin has effectively been in power in Russia since 2000. Time magazine has just announced its annual Person of the Year. This time, it's actually People of the Year, the growing list of men and women who've shared their stories of sexual assault and harassment. The magazine calls them the Silence Breakers. Apart from notable faces like actresses Ashley Judd, Selma Blair, and pop star Taylor Swift, Time magazine also interviewed women in various industries and traditions. They talked about their harrowing experiences and how they feel about starting the massive wave of exposing sex offenders. There were men, too. Actor Terry Crews and film writer Blaise Godby-Lipman were also featured. Massive wildfire being fanned by hot, dry desert winds has destroyed hundreds of homes in California and has forced thousands of residents to evacuate. The blaze, which is called the Thomas Fire, broke out on Monday evening in the foothills in Ventura County. Winds quickly drove it west into the city of Ventura, about 100 kilometers northwest of Los Angeles. California's governor has declared a state of emergency. More than 1,000 firefighters are battling to save homes from the flames. So far, none of the fire has been contained. A U.S. B-1B bomber flew over the Korean Peninsula today as part of a large-scale joint military drills with South Korea. Air Force drills, which began on Monday and run until Friday, have been denounced by North Korea as a rehearsal for an attack that is pushing the peninsula to the brink of nuclear war. They also come as top United Nations officials is in Pyongyang for a rare four-day visit. Jeffrey Feltman, the UN's Undersecretary General for Political Affairs, was invited by the North Korean government for wide-ranging talks. Before arriving in Pyongyang, Feltman was in Beijing, where he met with Vice Foreign Minister Li Baodong. Closer to home, in a new report, the European Union has labeled Macau a tax haven. However, the enclave is not taking the accusation lightly. Wina Wong reports.
The blacklist of 17 non-cooperative tax jurisdictions includes Guam, Panama, South Korea, and Macau. The European Union paper explained the enclave was included. European Union noted Hong Kong has agreed to introduce relevant changes to its tax legislation in order to comply with EU screening criteria. The Macau government, meanwhile, rejected its placement on the list. Authorities said the region is in no way a tax haven and actively operates with others in fighting tax evasion. Wina Wong, TVB News.
Well, the Transport Department has announced the arrangements for a hearing on the toll levels for the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge. The hearing will be held on December 21st in Zhuhai. Guangdong authorities have drafted the price-fixing proposals, which will be discussed.
Among the proposed tolls, 150 yuan per trip for private cars and 115 yuan for container trucks. The debate on amendments to LegCo's rules of procedure was due to start today, but PAN Democrats are throwing up roadblocks. Sharon Tang reports.
It's the quorum bell all the way. Early this afternoon, the pro-establishment camp played safe, ensuring there were enough members around to make a quorum. But later during the day, there were more quorum calls.
Call
for quorum, please.
Pro-establishment lawmakers left the chamber and got back at around 15 minutes later. Only a few PAN Democrats were spotted in the chamber. That, of course, was one of the tactics they used to prevent the meeting from moving forward. The pro-establishment camp explains how they'll fight back.
We are using the German proposal to tackle filibustering, because if we have to understand the background of this proposal, it is a kind of filibustering tactic to delay the rules of procedure proposal from discussing in the chamber.
There are 12 resolutions and 49 amendments to the rules of procedure. Most of the controversial amendments were proposed by pro-establishment lawmakers, such as lowering the threshold of the LegCo meeting quorum from half of its members to 20. They also suggest the power of the LegCo president be expanded so that he has to reject any motion that wasn't notified in advance. The PAN Democrats are worried that if these proposals are passed, the government will be able to forcibly pass any laws in the future. However, the LegCo president stands firm on his decision to combine debate on the resolutions and the amendments.
Unless the House committee have agreement that, you know, to divide it into a different session. Otherwise, you know, I would not consider it.
He also added that the LegCo secretariat is consulting the councillors on whether extra meetings should be scheduled. He hopes that the debate will be over before Christmas. Sharon Tang, TVB News.
Hong Kong's first vet school at City University will offer the SAR's first commercial postmortems for pets at its new diagnostic lab. Professors at the new college say the service can cut the waiting times for tests by half. Anne-Marie Sim reports.
The City University's College of Veterinary Medicine and Life Sciences has employed three veterinary pathologists to carry out the territory's first commercial postmortems for pets. They will carry out examinations and provide faster lab services for sick animals.
We have the pathologists located here in Hong Kong. We've employed pathologists from other countries, and they will be here and able to talk to the veterinarians and answer questions and do the testing and provide a rapid diagnostic service for the veterinarians, which ultimately will benefit the pet owners and the livestock owners, because they can get the diseases that are occurring in their animals diagnosed very quickly.
The lab, which started operating on Monday, can carry out postmortems on household pets and farm animals. But pet owners and farmers can't just walk in with the dead animals, they have to make a prior booking first. It's aimed at providing support to local vet clinics, farms and other institutions such as Ocean Park. Most tests can be carried out at the new lab, including tissue and hormone tests that could only be done overseas. The usual wait for results is a week to 2 weeks, but the lab can cut that time to between 1 and 4 days. It costs from $500 to $700 to send the samples and related documents overseas, so costs will be reduced too. The college hopes to train local pathologists in future. Anne-Marie Sim, TVB News.
In sports, a stunning move by the International Olympic Committee. It's banned Russia from participating in February's Winter Games in South Korea. The decision was more followed over the country's widespread doping program. Jameson Wong, more.
The report clearly lays out an unprecedented attack on the integrity of the Olympic Games and sports.
However, International Olympic Committee President Thomas Bach went on to say Russian athletes who are clean will be allowed to compete in Pyeongchang under the name Olympic Athlete from Russia. The ban comes after a 17-month investigation over allegations of state-sponsored doping at the 2014 Sochi Winter Olympics.
But really, Russia, somewhere seemingly.
In Russia, this woman said, this is a tragedy for the country. Our athletes are the strongest, so they are afraid of us and want to remove us from the arena. The Russian Olympic Committee expressed disappointment over the decision, while the Kremlin has yet to decide whether Russia will boycott the Games. The state broadcaster said it will not show the Olympics because the Russian team is not participating. Jameson Wong, TVB News.
Authorities are still trying to find the culprits in a case of football sacrilege. Police in Argentina say a vandal or vandals did a number on the bronze sculpture of Lionel Messi in Buenos Aires. The statue was chopped off at the ankles, with the body left on the pavement. This is not the first time his likeness has been targeted. In January, the figure was cut in half at the waist. French rock icon Johnny Hallyday has died at the age of 74. Known as the French Elvis, Hallyday packed sports stadiums and was the country's top rock star for decades. His stage aura was clearly fashioned around stars like Elvis Presley, and his musical inspiration came from the likes of Chuck Berry and Buddy Holly. But his stardom was largely confined to the French-speaking world. Hallyday had long suffered from lung cancer and had repeated health scares recently. In announcing his death, French President Emmanuel Macron said he brought a part of America to the national pantheon. Finally, the weather for you tonight. Cloudy periods in the morning with a low of about 18 degrees in urban areas. Mostly clear for Thursday with a high of 22 degrees. Generally clear for the weekend with cooler overnight lows. That is our time for the news. Thanks for joining us. Good night.